Thank you to Linda and to Bill for inviting me back to Tucson, and to Kate as well, my old comrade from graduate school. It's great to be back here. It is raining. That's much better than where I came from. It's 7,200 feet above sea level in Wyoming. It was snowing the day before Melissa and I left, so it's great to be back here. And it's great to see my former professors. I will take any chance I can to get back to Tucson. I started this project in 2012, and it's different from anything I've ever done before. I am an archaeologist, and I usually work with dead people. And dead people are actually a lot easier to work with, in my experience, than living ones. But there's a lot of advantages to working with living people, and ultimately my goal in studying the living is to help us understand the dead. Normally I am a Paleo-Indian archaeologist, and this project was inspired by work I did at a Folsom site in Middle Park, Colorado, a site called Barger Gulch, Locality B, thus the Folsom point that you see here. And I want to tell you how I made this transition. I still work in prehistoric sites. I do both, but specifically how I ended up working in northern Mongolia to answer questions about Paleo-Indian peoples. Before I do that, I want to start with one small anecdote about one thing that's advantageous about working with living people. You can actually ask them questions about why they do things. In the summer of 2012, I was camped across the river, the Jamis River, which you see here, camped across the river from a group of reindeer herders in northern Mongolia. They were living up on this terrace here. I was living on the opposite side of the river, and every day we'd cross the floodplain and cross the river and study what they were doing. And as we crossed the floodplain, we'd repeatedly passed this strange alignment of stones on the floodplain, and I had no idea what it was. And of course, being an archaeologist who works in Western North America, I've seen lots of stone alignments. But this one was enigmatic to me. It has a strange shape. It has 240 stones. It has one log incorporated in that perimeter. It has a line of stones bisecting it in the center. It's about 10 meters long and 5 meters wide. So every day I passed this thing, I pondered, what is it? You know, I thought, is this some kind of architectural feature? The Dukha, people who I study, for example, live in teepees. They don't call them teepees, but they make teepee rings. They weigh down the edges of the teepees with stones, which we find in the Great Plains up in Wyoming. This does not look like a teepee ring. It's too large. It's got a strange shape. It doesn't look particularly utilitarian. And this was my first summer there, so of course, being an archaeologist, I started wondering if it had something to do with shamanism. Eventually, I got up the nerve to ask, who made this and what's it for? And the people who made this construction were these people. Specifically, these people. And specifically for the purpose of having fashion shows. They live 30 miles from town, but they have satellite televisions. And they see fashion shows on TV. So they created a runway out of stones in the floodplain of the Jamis River. It walked down this side, come out here and pose, and walk out that side. The opportunity to study children's play features I did not anticipate, but I've since actually published a paper about this. And when you see stone alignments in the desert, I hope you think about this possibility then. So, how did I end up in Mongolia? Well, I worked in Colorado for a long time. I actually started working on this site in Colorado when I was a graduate student here in Tucson in a place called Middle Park. Middle Park forms the headwaters for the Colorado River. It is north of a place called South Park, which is a real place. And this is North Park, and this is Middle Park. The Colorado River flows west out of there, down this valley, and eventually down to the Grand Canyon. This is the headwaters of the Colorado River in Middle Park, and this is a site called Barker Gulch Locality B. This is a Folsom site. People spent the winter, we think they spent the winter, they spent a lot of time here, whatever season it was. At the end of the last ice age, roughly 12,400 years ago, this is a very rich site. The outline of our excavations there, you can see we excavated a big area. This is a square meter down here. 164 square meters excavated, which produced more than 75,000 pieces of chipstone and a very diverse lithic assemblage with all the goodies you find in Folsom sites. A very, very rich site, and shallowly buried because it's on top of this hill. There's no real source for sedimentation other than windblown sediments and what comes down this very shallow slope. So we were able to open up a big area, and we really focused our research design there on looking at spatial organization and social organization of a campsite where people lived 12,500 years ago. I should note Sherry Freeman in the back of the room was one of our excavators on that site. So we focused on spatial patterning, and it's easy to find. You can see all kinds of spatial patterns just looking at this. You can see wonderful clustering of stone artifacts associated with hearth features. You can see at certain sides of the hearth we have more artifacts than others. You can see clusters at multiple scales. There's all this fascinating spatial patterning that's very easy to identify and describe, but I found that understanding it was difficult. That we really didn't, as a field, we really hadn't developed, I felt, the theory to explain the patterns that we saw. Simple questions did not yield simple answers to me.
A simple question, like we dig a hearth feature, we find, say, 12,000 pieces of chipstone surrounding that feature.
Was that feature in an inside space or an outside space? We don't have pit houses. We don't have masonry walls. These are mobile hunter-gatherers who built rather impermanent structures that don't leave clear architectural remains. Yet whether this hearth sat in an inside space or an outside space has dramatic implications for how the spaces were used, whether this was a private space or a public space where people lived and slept. But looking at that scatter, it's not clear. We were able, we think, to identify the presence of three structures on this site. And we were able to do that by looking at barrier effects. So we're looking at how at major changes in spatial distributions of artifacts across space that I don't really have time to talk about. And then with fairly consistent patterns, we have breaks in these spatial patterns on the north sides of these households, we think. But there's probably much simpler ways of answering this question. Rather than looking for walls, which is what we were doing, one might ask, how do people position themselves around a fire in an inside space versus an outside space? There's good reasons why we might expect the distribution of people around fires in each kind of space to be different. Heat is distributed differently, for example, once you put a wall around a fire or a roof over it. And how would those spatial decisions that people make about where to do things be manifested in the archaeological record? Now, this is a very simple question, but I can tell you that we don't know the answer to this question. And if you wanted to understand how artifacts would accumulate around hearth features in the archaeological record, which is a problem not unique to the Barker Gulch site in Colorado, but common to archaeological sites around the world, you think you might want to know the answer to this question. But I felt like we don't know the answer to this question. If we look at how artifacts are distributed in the households we reconstructed at Barker Gulch, it's a fairly consistent pattern. The gray arcs show that the side of the hearth that have the highest densities of artifacts. In two of the houses, you see a very clear pattern that on one side of the hearth and towards the back, we have the highest densities of artifacts. It's not really true in this area. It's a little more chaotic. But it inspired a very simple question, which is why? How would you expect artifacts to accumulate in a space like this? Nomadic people, hunter-gatherers, living in small structures, where would they make and use stone tools? If you were sitting inside of a teepee and making a stone tool, where would you sit?
Near the light.
Near the light? That's one answer I commonly get. If you repeated this act 100 times, what would the distribution of locations look like? Would it always be in the same place? So that's one of the answers I get. Some people say near the hearth, where there's heat and light. This is a model by an anthropologist named Gerald Otelar of how teepee spaces would have been used. Near the hearth, where there's heat and light, well, that gives you 360 degrees of options. Where near the hearth? Near the wall, maybe, to get out of the way. Near the door, where there's light. In the back of the house, where it's not windy. On the left side or the right side? Are there cultural rules that dictate these kind of things? Does it depend on where other people are sitting? We've been studying domestic spaces and architecture and anthropology for a long, long time. I don't know the answers to these questions. And yet, if we want to understand how artifacts would accumulate in household spaces in the past, or going back to my original problem, interpret the meaning of the distribution of artifacts around hearths in an archaeological site, it would be good to have some understanding of this question. It made me want to see it in the real world. People who live in a somewhat similar setting, a somewhat similar lifestyle, how do they use household spaces? That brought me to Mongolia. I thought, where can I find nomadic people living in a temperate environment? And there aren't many choices. Central Asia, politically a little problematic now. Northeast Asia is basically the best option, Russia or Mongolia, and I think the reason why I chose Mongolia is because actually I was in the Department of Anthropology at the University of Arizona, and John Olson had worked in Mongolia, and my old roommate Jeff Brantingham had worked in Mongolia, and they had some prior connections there that made it seemed a little bit easier for me to begin working in Mongolia than in Siberia. So I'm going to give John a little bit of credit here for me ending up in Mongolia. These are the Dukha. Her son is getting married. So they killed a reindeer because they have 75 people showing up for the wedding and they need to feed those people. She's got a bowl full of blood and she's filling up these intestines with blood and tying them off to boil to make blood sausage. It's actually quite tasty compared to most things I eat in Mongolia. Ethnoarchaeology, for those of you who aren't really familiar with it, I think the simplest definition is the study of living people for the purpose of developing tools to help us understand the archaeological record. I'm hardly the first person to do ethnoarchaeology to answer spatial questions in archaeology. The difference between what I'm doing and what has been done in the past is that I am mapping people in space. In the past, ethnoarchaeologists have gone to places like Australia. Jim O'Connell has gone to Australia and mapped campsites and refuse in, say, the deserts of Australia to see how artifacts accumulate. John Yellen did the same thing in the Kalahari with the Chowansi. I'm also mapping houses and fireplaces and refuse, but I'm also mapping people directly. And this is the focus of what I do, direct mapping of people. Because I'm trying to understand how people decide where to do what they do. The major focus of my work right now is looking at how the spatial organization of human behavior changes seasonally, ultimately with the goal of developing methods for determining the season of occupation of archaeological sites, looking at variation in the spatial distribution of artifacts. Although I think the value of this work goes much beyond that. And again, that seasonal interest goes back to Barker. We think it's a winter campsite, but we don't know. Underlying everything we do is a spatial decision that we make. You all are sitting where you're sitting because you made a spatial decision. In part, that decision was made for you today because the sign told you which table to sit at, but you chose what seat to sit at. How did you make that decision? Everything you do, you make a similar decision. You just don't think about it. But we have to make a decision about where we do things. She has made a decision about where she's going to position herself to renew the brand on that reindeer. Every reindeer is owned by an individual family and they're branded, not with heat, but by using scissors to cut the brand out of the fur, and it has to be renewed regularly. My idea, and this was a simple idea, that if we can map people, in addition to the junk that hits the ground, frequently in spaces like this, we can develop data sets that will allow us to understand how these spatial decisions are made. The challenge, of course, was how do you do this? How do you map people frequently in the middle of nowhere in the taiga in Mongolia, say every 2 minutes, record where everybody is in a camp, and do it precisely, say with 10 centimeter accuracy, and unobtrusively so they don't hate you. If I walk up to you every 3 minutes with a tape measure, you're not gonna like me, right? So that was the technical challenge I had to solve, which I've done to the extent that I can, and I'll explain to you how I've done that. For those of you who aren't super familiar with Mongolia, this is Mongolia. It sits on top of China. China to the south, Russia to the north. This is a big place. It is about 1.5 million square kilometers. It is 5 times the size of Arizona. It is the 18th largest country in the world. It is roughly the size of Alaska. You know, probably don't think of reindeer when you think of Mongolia. Most of the country is arid to semi-arid. It's hot in the southern part of the country in the Gobi. Actually, Ulaanbaatar, the national capital, which is somewhere in this area here, is the coldest national capital on the planet. And I work in far northern Mongolia in the province called Hufskul. This is Hufskul Nur, or Hufskul Lake, or the Mongolians sometimes call it the Hufskul Sea. Most people don't think of lakes when they think of Mongolia. This is not a small lake. This is Lake Baikal. They call it Baikal's little sister. This is 80 miles north to south, this lake. This is the Darkhat Depression. To the west of the Darkhat Depression are the Sayan Mountains, and this is where Mongolia's reindeer herders live, the Dukha. This is Russia. This is the border with Russia. They live about 30 to 40 miles from the border with Russia, and they migrated to Mongolia after World War II. They're of Tuvan descent. After World War II, they migrated to Mongolia. The Mongolian government tried to kick them out a few times. They kept coming back. This is what a Dukha summer camp looks like. I'm a plains archaeologist. To ride a horse into a camp like this, I can't tell you how cool that is. That's the only way to get in here is on horseback. And it's 2 days on horseback into the summer camps, which makes my knees hurt. Not much of a horseman, but you don't have a choice here. They are nomadic. Some families are more nomadic than others. Some families make 4 or 5 camps a year. Some families live in the taiga. They call this the taiga in the summertime, and then they move to town for the winter where their kids go to school. Some families maintain 4 camps a year, a summer camp, a fall camp, a winter camp, and a spring camp. Their subsistence is based on reindeer. The reindeer provide meat and milk, but I would say the next most important foodstuff is wheat flour, refined white flour they purchase in town and pack into the taiga. Other store-bought goods are used occasionally. And then they also use wild plant and animal foods. And all the Duhka number about 200 people who live in two separate geographic areas called the left and right taigas. This is the summer camp I studied in 2012. There were 9 families in this camp, all related. They call this the taiga, and most of this area, taiga means boreal forest. They're above tree line here, so this is really alpine tundra, which is a great place to graze reindeer in the summertime. But there's no firewood, so you have to pack in your firewood for the summer. They're in this camp for about 2.5 months. So you regularly see trains of packwood being, or trains of firewood being packed in. Reindeer are used for packing and for riding. Yes, I've ridden a reindeer. Usually the reindeer are saddled. He's got it saddled. Sometimes they're not. The young boys will often hop on them and cruise around. Here they're bringing the deer back from grazing in the late afternoon, and he's just jumped on one and he's riding it back. They are milked. Reindeer milk tastes like milk. It's not bad at all. They're used for meat, although sparingly. The average herd size per family is about 30 animals. Most of the pastoralists in Mongolia, they're sheep and goat herders, and they have herds that number in the hundreds, if not thousands. They can kill a sheep or a goat weekly. Most families in the taiga will kill 1 or 2 deer a year because that's all they can afford, and they use the meat very sparingly. Again, this is the deer that was killed on the occasion of this one of the sons in this family getting married. The reindeer hide is also used. This was last fall. She's rehydrating a dried hide. She's going to scrape it down and make it nice and pliable. She said she was making a dell with fur for a friend as a gift. A dell is a traditional Mongolian jacket. I have not seen anybody wearing fur clothing. They used to, they don't anymore, except for children. They still make them reindeer hide boots. Fishing I've seen in the summertime. This guy is fishing with a spear. It's actually a gaff. You could see under the water on the end of that pole is a gaff hook. When a fish swims through that loop, he pulls that back towards him and spears the fish. Normally, most of the fishing I've seen has been with a hand line, which you kind of whip out into the stream, lasso it out there. You put a grasshopper on a hook with float, and when the fish hits it, you pull it back. It's not a delicate procedure. Man, they yank these fish out, and the fish go flying out. It's not really reeling them in. It's more yanking them out. But they do pretty well. This is the hoofschool grayling, which is present in the streams in the taiga. Delicious when grilled. Gathering really ramps up in the summer, especially the late summer and fall. There's an individual gathering wild plant food in this photo. Can you find him? And it is a him. Right there. Pine nuts, yeah. If you can't really see them very well, they're pine cones here. This is the Siberian pine. These things are eaten all over Mongolia. In the taiga, they're very plentiful. You collect the cones and you roast them and you pick apart the cone scale by scale and crack the seeds in your mouth and eat them. This is a root. It's really a bulb. They call it shartumus, or yellow potato, but it's an iris. Many berries are taken in the taiga. Blueberries would be most familiar to you. They call this anise, which is not the anise that we know of. I've looked it up botanically. I don't recall exactly what species it is, but it's a very tiny red berry that grows on a little plant that only is maybe 1 or 2 inches off the ground, and you find it carpeting the taiga in forested areas. This is the Duhka household. In Siberia, you would call this a chum. It's a conical lodge. The Duhka call it an orts. It's not dissimilar from a teepee. One major difference is that it's made of multiple parts. typically 5 pieces of canvas. It's very adjustable in size. It's big. They average about 6 meters in diameter, or about 20 feet. Typically about 30 lodge poles of larch, occasionally pine. I've seen as many as 9 people live in one of these and as few as 9. They have electricity provided by solar panels and large batteries, not all of them, most of them. The doors are south facing. There's a sheet metal stove in the center, and you can see the stovepipe sticking out of the top there. This is the typical organization of an orts in a summer camp anyway, and I tried to make a panorama around the entire perimeter here. So here's the doorway here, here's the same doorway. So we're just looking all the way around the edge. And typically when you walk in, the door would be here on the south side, southeast side, and you walk in and on the right, like a Mongolian gir or yurt, the kitchen is immediately to the right and then alternates between beds and storage with the stove in the center. The Dukha say that the eastern or right side is the woman's side and the western or left side is the man's side. So you can see that here nicely. Kitchen, bed, storage, bed, storage, bed, storage. If there's a television in the house, it tends to be in the back center along the midline, right in this area here. Here's something hanging from one of the lodge poles. Any guesses as to what that is? That's this guy. It's super cool to be in a teepee in the Mongolian taiga and have a baby sleeping in a cradle board. I'm sure this is a technology that is tens of thousands of years old. And then you look to your left and you see a nice flat screen television and DVD player in Korean docudramas or Disney's Sacagawea or Pocahontas or... The worst thing I watched in the taiga in the middle of nowhere was the movie Face Off with John Travolta and Nicolas Cage, where they have their faces surgically exchanged. These people are part of the modern world, very much so. The American television to which they are exposed, I would not say, is the best of our cultural offerings. Bull riding, a lot of bull riding, professional bull riding. You can imagine in Mongolia that would be popular. If you want to have a television and be nomadic, there are no roads into this area. You need a television and a big battery pack and solar panels and everything. The DVD player you don't have to have, some families do. Satellite dish. So, but you put up with it, because apparently television is important, and it really is. I've often thought that the invention of the flat screen television is much more important to these people than it is to us. When you have to pack your television around the taiga, I mean, sure, it saves space in our living rooms, but on a reindeer, it saves a lot of space. Satellite dish, notice the rifle over here. Also notice they're not corralling these animals. Way up above tree line, building a corral is an expensive proposition. There are a few, but when you have, some of these families have up to 120 deer, it's a lot easier to stake them out individually than to build a corral because you have to pack in all the wood. I have moved camp once. This was in 2013 when we moved from summer to fall camp. When we packed everything, all of his belongings, onto this pack train. We're riding down an elevation about 300 meters into the forest and then back up to tree line. This is where they spend the fall. This is his son on the deer behind him in a car seat, essentially. This is a kid's saddle and he's tied in. He's probably asleep, as most kids are when they... You put him in the car seat. Last fall, I spent the fall here. This is a place called Higadek. This is in the middle of nowhere. This is probably the most remote place I've ever been. there's nothing between here and the Russian border, and I think we're 40 miles from town. Camp is right here. Can you see it? Two little teepees there, that was my house there. These yellow trees are larch, they're deciduous conifers. They turn yellow and most of them will lose their leaves in the winter. The green ones are the pine trees. Nice alpine lakes in this area. This is what that camp looked like at treeline. This again was my house here, and two families lived there. That's what it's like to be in the Mongolian taiga. It's fascinating. It's awesome. It's really exciting. I'm always very happy there, and I can't wait to get back. I'm actually going back in about 5 weeks. But I am doing some science there, too. Specifically, as I mentioned to you, mapping people in these spaces to try to understand how people make decisions about where they do things. And the way I do this, I use two different methods. I use a method called photogrammetry in outside spaces, which means mapping or measuring from photographic images. And specifically, I use time-lapse photography. And I use photogrammetric software to measure the location of people from that imagery. And I'll show you how that works in a second. In indoor spaces, I do a very simple method with pencil and paper. Then I also collect weather data because I think weather has a huge impact on where people do things. You guys know that in the summertime here when you avoid the sun, and you know it today when you're not outside in the rain, right? This is my camera system. This is the best way I could figure out how to do this in an unobtrusive way. I mount a camera up on a pole. It's inside of this box. There's a solar panel on top of that. It's a basic off-the-shelf Canon digital SLR with a big battery pack programmed to take photos automatically every 2 or 3 minutes. I focus it at a household and it just sits there and it takes pictures. I have to say the first time I put this up, never used this system before. I just arrived in Mongolia. I just met these people, told them I wanted to do this. And they said, why do you want to do that? I'm going to put a camera in front of my house? And I said, well, and I explained to them why, and they were not terribly happy about it, but they were okay with it. And I said, do you mind if I put the camera here? And they said, you can put it there, but the horses like to go there. And I said, okay, well, you know, can I put it over there? And they're like, well, the yaks like to go there. So I put the thing up. We go back to our camp. We hear all this commotion, and the camera is on the ground. The horses got tangled up in the lines, and the thing went slamming to the ground from 15 feet up in the air, and thankfully did not break. And then they showed us how to really stake things out. Which they're amazingly skilled at, as you can imagine. The way we map from photographic imagery is by marking points on the ground surface and surveying their location. So we have points on the ground surface that we know their exact location that will appear in those photographs. And we can measure the location of people relative to those known points on the ground surface. So here we are surveying in those points with a very old school method of builder's level. We're very limited in terms of electricity out there. Everything we bring in is charged by solar panel, or not charged at all. This doesn't require any batteries. It's perfectly effective. GPS is not precise enough to give us the kind of data we need. So here's a typical image, time-lapse image from my camera system. This is my colleague, by the way. This is Matt O'Brien, who's now a professor at California State University Chico, who works with me on this project. He was one of my former students at the University of Wyoming. He got his PhD after that at the University of New Mexico. In this photograph, I have control points that we've surveyed in on the ground surface encircling this whole scene. You can't see them very well because they're supposed to be not very intrusive, but what they are yellow plastic tent stakes that we've hammered into the ground until flush. And they circle this entire area. And then using photogrammetric software, we can now define the surface, and now we can map the location of anything on that surface in that image, whether this person or these guys over here doing some woodworking, or these houses, or these deer, or the wood pile. And we can map it very precisely with about 4-inch accuracy or 10 centimeter accuracy. One nice byproduct of using time-lapse photography is that we can make time-lapse movies if I can get it to work. So I'm going to show you, if I can make this work, 3 days in a reindeer herd or camp compressed to 1 minute. 803 images or 40 hours of time compressed to 1 minute. To Mozart, if you can hear it. By watching this movie, you can see that by this method, we can actually... You can see the spatial distribution of behavior beautifully. It shows up very nicely. And think about what we can get from this, not just the location of where people do things, but who those people are. We can say, where are they? Who are they? Are they male? Are they female? What's their age? Who are they related to? Which household do they live in? What activity are they doing? What tools are they using? What time of day are they doing this? What's the weather like when they're doing this? We can break this down many, many, many different ways and really understand how people use space and I think why they make those spatial decisions. So we have thousands of images like this from summer camps and fall camps, and I want to get this from spring camps and winter camps as well, which is why I'm leaving for Mongolia on the winter solstice and hope I come back with all my fingers and toes in January. And inside spaces, I would never put a camera inside somebody's private space and have it take pictures automatically. It's just too private of a space. Because these are round spaces of consistent, relatively consistent size, we can map where people are in these spaces fairly accurately just using this form. So what we do is we choose random times of day, literally, as long as it's reasonable visiting hours, and a random house, and we'll go to that house for 20-minute periods and record people and where they're doing things on this form. So we've just bisected this round house in every possible way as guidelines for estimating the position of people, and every minute we'll cycle through a different person. 1:57 p.m. on July 27, 2012, in house number 5. The first point is 5F2. That's the person. She lives in house 5. She's a female, and she's the second oldest female in that house. Looks like she's sawing antler with a handsaw. And she's sitting right here while she's doing that. And we do this repeatedly over and over and over again, so we get a very good idea of how these spaces are used. Once we have thousands of data points like this as well from many, many different households at different times of day. We try to do it from outside the house if possible. So once you go in a house like this, your location will affect other people's locations and the distribution of their behavior. So we try to do it from outside the house if possible. If we have to go inside, and we often do because the door is closed, I will try to sit in a different place every time so I don't add any systematic bias to these data. Bring a weather station into the taiga, that's right here, and it gives us all kinds of data, temperature, humidity, dew point, wind speed, wind direction. This shows temperature from 2012 in degrees Fahrenheit, July and August. This is freezing, 32 degrees. Even in July and August, we were getting down below freezing fairly regularly. But this is at 7,200 feet above sea level at 51 degrees north latitude. This is a reindeer, an Arctic, subarctic species, so it's a cold environment. In December, I'm preparing for minus 40. And if you're wondering what that is, well, that's Celsius, but it's the same in Fahrenheit. That's where the two scales interact. Should be interesting. So for every dot on the map, they're getting a shower, by the way, from their mama. Every dot on the map, we know the person, their identity, their age, sex, the household they live in, the activity they're doing, the equipment they're using, and all kinds of weather information. This And I'm not going to give you a lot of scientific results here. I'll give you a few of the kinds of things that we can look at. And some of the things that we have found, we're still very much working on these data. But when you take that time-lapse video and you map everybody in it, this is the distribution that you end up with, at least for that one scene that I showed you. This is 1,600 human locations. Those are the households there. These are shadows. These are places I can't see the ground surface because they're obscured by the house. Where you see somebody in that, it's usually because they're just obscured by the edge of the house and we're guessing where their feet are. You can see that there's, at least the coarse scale, there's major clustering around what I would call spatial attractors. You see major clustering around doorways. These are for really two reasons. One, these are pinch points, or they constrict human movement. Going in and out of that house, you have to go through a very narrow space, so people are very likely to occur in that space. But also, as I'll show you in a second, doorfront areas, or what I'd like to call front porch areas, are very common workspaces as well. Wood piles, where firewood is stored, are common work areas as well, and you see a major cluster associated with that wood pile. This is because wood is not only burned, it's not only a lot of chopping of wood for burning, but a lot of furniture was being made, again, because the son in this household was getting married, so they were making wooden furniture to outfit his house. And then the reindeer area back here, this is a big cluster of people working with the deer, which are staked out behind the house here. It shows another household scene. This is a little corral here. This family had a small herd of goats. So there's a major cluster of points around that goat corral, which you think might be tending of goats. It's not. Most of those points are children. And it's not because they corral children in there. It's because kids play on that. They climb up and down on those fences of that corral. Again, a cluster here associated with this wood pile, a major cluster associated with the house front and the doorway. And you can see streams are showing up beautifully. When you have to cross a creek in front of your house, you build a small footpath out of stone, and that, again, funnels people to very specific locations. And this footpath here is going to the neighbor's house next door. One thing that became very clear to us very quickly is that doorway, doorfront areas are very common areas for use. I was disappointed to find that the Dukha don't use exterior hearth features. The only hearth features they use are interior. Now, on a couple of occasions I've seen them use exterior hearth features, but as compared to the many of the archaeological sites I've worked on, we don't have clear evidence. We don't have, say, a paired interior and exterior workspace associated with a hearth. People will commonly come right outside the door, just to the left or the right of the door, and use this area in front of the door as a workspace. Another thing we've noticed, which isn't terribly surprising, but you don't realize it until you see it, perhaps, is that walkways have primacy. People tend to avoid walkways in positioning themselves. It's very true today, and it's very true in any space. You don't sit in front of a doorway because you're often going to get displaced. I think the reason why people are using these outside spaces adjacent to doorways is simply because there's the closest outside spaces. So if you have to do an activity that's messy, like laundry, or a big sewing job, then you need a lot of space. She's actually grinding wild onion flowers, and you need to go outside, you're going to choose the closest available space, which is just outside the door. But you don't want to be in front of the door. This shows a composite from our summer camp data, I think 900 human locations inside Dukha Ortses. And you can see it's highly patterned where people are positioned inside of these houses. This shows the distribution by angle. There's a very strong eastern bias. People tend to be very strongly on the eastern side. This is from 6 different households, 15 hours of observation. There's a strong eastern bias and a weak northern bias. People are slightly more likely to be in the back of the house, much more likely to be on the eastern side of the house. In part, I think there are structural reasons why this might be true. For example, this is the stove, and inside of that house, the doorway of that, or the what do you call it? The opening on that stove where you maintain the fire is on the eastern side. So if you're tending that fire, you're most likely to do it from that side. Also, the kitchen is on the eastern side. So if you are cooking, you're also very likely to be on the eastern side of the house. We can also look at this in terms of distance, how people are positioned relative to the center of the house or the edge. This is the center here, and this is simply the density of people in this space. And there's a clear bimodal pattern. People are most likely to be either along the edge of the house near the wall or in the center of the house, but the area in between is left relatively vacant. I think that's in part, again, to leave a space for people to move through the house. Interestingly, a Dutch archaeologist named Dick Stapert has argued that if you look at the density of artifacts as a function of distance from a hearth, that if you see this pattern, a bimodal pattern, it indicates an interior space. He argued that on the basis of saying that artifacts tend to accumulate by the hearth where people work, or they push them up against the walls. If this was happening in prehistory, you might expect a bimodal distribution to occur just because that's how people appear to use spaces like this. Gender, how does gender play out? Again, there's a cultural gender model at play here. They say the eastern
side is the woman's side, the western side is the man's side. How does that play out?
In terms of where men and women and boys and girls sit in these houses. On the top, you see males, and on the bottom, you see females. And what's interesting is that females are preferentially found on the women's side of the house, and males are preferentially found on the women's side of the house. Everybody likes the women's side of the house. There are differences, slight differences in gender positioning. Women are slightly more likely to be towards the front of the house. Men are slightly more likely to be towards the back of the house. I should note, women occur also on the men's side of the house, and men also do too. So there are subtle differences in gender, but they don't clearly relate to the gender model that is assigned to the house. If anything, these differences are due to the fact that cooking is primarily, not exclusively, but primarily a female activity. And if you are cooking, you tend to be found in this area here, which I think displaces men to other areas. They occasionally occur there too. I think what's going on here is that everybody's hanging out in the kitchen, which is a common phenomenon in a lot of households, for good reason, because that's where the food comes from. If you're near the food, you get the food, right? So she's on the woman's side of the house, he's on the woman's side of the house, and he's looking at the meat on the woman's side of the house. The biggest difference between these two sides of the house is, from what I can tell, is that this tends to be the east side tends to be the family's side of the house, and the west side is more for guests. But that's not universal as either. So I think in this case, gender impacts positioning primarily through the division of labor, and it begins with the fact that women do most of the cooking, most of the fire tending as well. One thing that we've done for obvious reasons to this audience, somebody said light matters a lot. I think light does matter a lot in terms of where we choose to do things. I think heat matters a lot too. So we've measured the distribution of light in these spaces using a handheld light meter. It looks something like this. And these numbers, you don't have to really worry about what they mean. They're in the unit lux, which is not an intuitive unit to me. I don't work in light intensity units very often, but here's a scale way for comparison. 50,000 lux is a very sunny day. A hallway is 50 lux. With a door open in a Dukha Ortz, it's very bright around the door. That's prime, it's where most of the light comes in. So it's very, very bright in the front of the house and considerably more dim in the back of the house, but still pretty bright compared to what happens when the door is closed. Most of the light is in the center of the house coming through the vent in the top. And this doorway area now becomes one of the darkest parts of the house, interestingly. So to what extent does this control where people do things? Well, if you're interested in how stone tools might accumulate in these spaces, you might want to focus on specific kinds of activities. And that's what we're starting to do, looking at production activities specifically. So these are, I'm getting ahead of myself. Not production activities yet, but this is the overall distribution of human behavior in summer camps. This is the same scatter you've been seeing, and for comparison, this is fall camps. And looking at those scatters, you probably can't pick out the differences, but there are differences, and they're quite interesting. In summer camps, so this shows angle, okay? So this is north of the hearth here, and this is south of the hearth here at 180 degrees. So I'm dividing this up radially into 45 degree increments. In the, both in summer and fall camps, we have this strong eastern bias. What changes is that in the fall households, we see slightly more emphasis on the back of the house, particularly back in here, we have a lot more occurrences of people. In the summer, we see a lot more people up in the front of the house. If we look at this same effect with respect to distance and see how people position themselves relative to the inner half of the house near the fire or the outer half near the wall of the house, in the fall, they're much more likely to be towards the inside of the house. About 43% of observations in the fall are towards the center of the house, compared to only 30% in the summer, where people are much more likely to be out towards the edges. This is, I think, about thermoregulation. The heat is coming from the center of the house. The average daytime temperature in the summer was 13 degrees Celsius, in the fall 0.9, or around freezing. People are moving to the center of the house. If you look at production activities, so this is people making things, and I've separated out food production and fire production, which tend to be very structured in space. So the red dots here are fire production, and you can see almost always from the eastern side of the house and very close to the stove. And food production, making food, almost always on the eastern side of the house. Everything else in gray here. Everything else would include woodwork, bone, antler work, hide work, metal work. It's actually very different from what we see in terms of the overall distribution of activity. It tends to be in the summer towards the front of the house, primarily in this area here. We see a very strong bias. This is the front of the house here, the south side, and the back of the house here. We see preferentially it occurring in the front of the house, and I think to take advantage of available light. And you can see that very clearly here. He's making a pin. They're making some, getting ready to make some sausage, and he's making a wooden pin to tie it up. And you can see the light pouring in through the door at his back. You can also see the little guy who doesn't want his picture taken. In the fall, this changes dramatically. Again, food and fire production are in roughly the same locations, but other production activity shifts to the back of the house, where we have roughly two-thirds of these activities happening in the back of the house. This is probably due to changing light conditions, simply because the door is closed a lot when it gets cold. You close the door. And now that area in front of the door, which was the brightest and best place to work, becomes one of the darkest places to work, and people are moving more towards the center and actually towards the back of the house. If you think about what this means in terms of artifacts and how artifacts might accumulate in these spaces seasonally, there might be clear differences that we would expect. In the summer, the overall distribution of activity, including production activities, is biased towards the front of the house. Also, people are more likely to be on the outsides of houses. Whereas in the fall, this changes. They're more likely to move in towards the center of the house to be warmer and towards the back of the house when they're using tools and making things. So we might expect artifacts to accumulate in very different ways in warm season and cold season occupation houses. And interestingly, at Barger Gulch, where we see artifacts preferentially accumulating in the backs of houses, it may suggest we're dealing with a cold season occupation, as we long suspected. A couple of quick conclusions. I think the spatial distribution of artifacts in sites is governed by a lot of things, but the first thing is how people decide where they do things. Secondly, things like, well, refuse disposal. They might not leave their trash where they created it initially, as Mike Schiffer has long said, from the University of Arizona, and certainly other kinds of things that might disturb patterning in the archaeological record. natural formation processes. But fundamentally, the first thing we have to understand is, how do people decide where they do things? And that's what I'm trying to understand here. And I think that studying this directly will ultimately be a big boon to archaeological interpretation when we're looking at spatial patterning. And I really, really hope that other people can do this kind of work and do it in a wide variety of settings beyond the ones where I have first applied it here. My initial results suggest, I think, that human spatial behavior on small scales is very predictable and very understandable in ways that I think will ultimately help us to understand the archaeological record. So thank you for listening, and I'd be happy to entertain any questions that you have today. Yes?
What are the floors of the tents made out of, and do they sweep stuff out?
Most households have a floor, rugs or canvas floors. They are regularly swept. Regularly swept out the front door. Sometimes if you have a doormat, they'll sweep it under the doormat so the stuff isn't brought back in. When they built a house for me to live in, they did not put a floor in it initially, but it was in a very boggy area, so they actually put in a bunch of pine needles to soften it up and dry it up, and then they put canvas on top of that. Upon leaving camp, most families will sweep the floor as well to make sure that they haven't left anything. Yes, ma'am.
So I take the rock band out to a petroglyph site, and this year we have a picnic table to eat lunch on. And we've only been out there twice, but the first time we all sat down and ate. I noticed the second time that we tended to choose the same places as we sat the time before. So isn't there a habitual sort of thing? Because you can see everywhere, and every spot at the picnic table is, well, approximately the same, except you have to climb over the bench in the middle. But
yes,
there's habit.
Absolutely. Many of us in this room teach classes, and we observe this in every classroom where we teach. Students sit in the same places all the time, and we get mad when they don't, because we learn their names based on where they sit. Yeah, those habits form, and I can certainly look at individual behavior in this case and see to what extent the same people are found in the same places. My impression, I haven't done that yet, my impression, having lived in this situation, is yes, it's absolutely true. Particularly for the elderly individuals, the senior members of those households, they have their spot, and that tends to displace other people from that spot. And the kids are kind of all over the place. I think it plays a part, it plays a role. I think we ultimately then have to understand how that decision is made initially, in terms of why you guys sat at that table the way you did the first time. I don't think they've thought about it until you mentioned it. Sherry.
Off the wall, but I'm thinking about folds of lithics, and on the floor, wouldn't safety be a concern if you're probably barefooted? Because those lithics are sharp.
It's an awesome question. So, yeah, you would think so, right? And we have ethnographic cases where we've observed
people flint knapping, for example, indigenous people flint knapping in Australia, in Papua New Guinea, Ethiopia come to mind.
The Ethiopian case and the Papua New Guinean case, they swept the lithic debitage away for that reason. It is dangerous for barefoot people. At Barger, you have houses full of lithics, and Barger is not unique that way. There's houses from the Upper Paleolithic that way, there are houses from the Mesolithic, where the floors are just absolutely littered with chipped stone, which makes me think they're not barefooted, for one. And if you're not barefoot, and you don't have your skin on the ground, is it really a problem? Whether you view lithic debitage as a noxious material or something that needs to be removed, I think is going to have a massive impact on archaeological spatial patterning. And I think it's pretty clear in the case of Barger Gulch that they did not. Because here we have hearth spaces where all the lithics are right on top of those hearths, which are also where we know people worked, right? So they didn't. But we also have clear cases Well, we've observed people, modern flint knappers today, they always clean up their stuff for the same reason. They don't want to hurt people. But in many cases in the Stone Age, people clearly did not feel that way. It makes me wonder if in cold environments where your skin is protected and your feet aren't bare, it's not a big deal. In warm environments, maybe it is, but I don't know. It's something that I think could easily be studied. It's a great question.
That would almost go along with the site, then. It's a cold weather site. It's protected.
Yeah, I think so. Also, I mean, a lot of people have talked about you can put down a floor covering, bison robe, for example, when you're sleeping, and when you're flint napping, pick the thing up, and then so it's covered is another possibility. But I think you're right. I think it supports the idea that it's a cold weather site. Yeah, Vance.
Todd, what use are they making of the dogs? Any use of the dogs?
Yeah, great question. What I was told was the dog's primary job is guarding the camp. And guarding the camp from wolves, specifically. When I was there last fall, they lost 6 deer to wolves. And we saw wolf prints within about 200 meters of camp. I never saw a wolf. So dogs, their primary job is to be an early alert system for wolves. Anybody, when you're sitting around camp and you hear the dogs go bananas, you know something's coming into camp, usually people. The other main use of the dogs is hunting. So I have not gone hunting. Hunting is a bit of a touchy subject because there are legal issues around hunting. But dogs are primarily used to hunt small game and sable. They will usually chase sable, tree them where they can be shot. Sometimes a dog is capable of catching a sable. Greg. Yeah, we've started doing that. One of my interests here, we know if we look at human, if we look at the Paleolithic, from the lower Paleolithic through the upper Paleolithic, we know that the spatial structure of archaeological sites changes. I don't know that we know entirely how or why. It seems to become more clustered, more associated with hearth features. They say more functionally differentiated. I don't know if that's been established yet. But it fundamentally raises the question of what is modern human spatial behavior compared to pre-modern human spatial behavior. And we do have a non-human species here that we have the spatial distribution of. Yes, and for the summer camp, we have plotted the dogs. And it's not as different from the people as I had hoped. Dogs spend a lot of time right outside the door. Because that's where the dog treats come from. They get tossed right out the door. You know, this, I'll say, my intent was to map people. But then, as you're going through this imagery, you realize there is so much data embedded in this imagery that I haven't even dreamed of, that I hope people will be using long after I'm gone. For example, I have a student who's interested in thermoregulation in clothing, and I said, well, I have all this clothing data compared to weather data and what people are wearing that I had no intention of gathering, but I do. It's a cool data set. Yes?
Are you going to look at whether, and you already know this, where if they actually go to the exact same spot each time they put up their homes in the seasons? You know, they go to, each summer they go to the exact same spot. If they don't put their yurt up or whatever in the exact same spot, doesn't that really change the distribution issues? How do you know, how do you factor that in?
From an archaeological perspective, if we had repeated use of the same campsite and the houses are moving around slightly and you're trying to sort out what's going on, it would be really, really difficult. Yes. I can now model that pretty well, right? I know how people use space in these situations, and I could model, let's move the house over 3 meters and repeat the process, which is a nice thing. I don't record that. I have been back to a summer camp that was used in successive years. I'm not able to know if the houses are in exactly the same location. They make these teepee rings, but interestingly, when they move, they pile up the stones into cairns. They become cairns, and then they a small pile of stones. They don't leave a ring like they do in the plains. So I don't know if it's exactly the same spot. Most of the households were pretty much where I remembered them, so I know they're within, you know, 5-10 meters, but I don't know. I think that repeated use of the same campsites is my impression. I don't know this with a lot of confidence. It's very common for pastoralists. It's less common for hunter-gatherers. These pastoralists invest in these campsites. They build the corrals. They've made 300 stakes to tie down reindeer. They've made clotheslines. They make volleyball nets, basketball hoops. And when you start investing in a place like that, you have incentive to use it until the ground becomes so beat up you have to move 100 meters downstream. But I don't think that's true for hunter-gatherers as much. Other questions? Lisa?
Yeah, Todd, do you have a sense of the long-term or maybe an immediate-term prognosis for these people and their way of life? And is your work going to inform that at all?
I have a sense for it, and I've talked to them about it. I don't think it's going to last much longer. I asked them, you know, what's your long-term prognosis? And they said, I don't know. They don't seem terribly worried about it. The biggest problem, in my opinion, well, we can talk about climate change, because they're the southernmost reindeer herders in the world. They're on the edge of reindeer habitat, and they're against the international border. So if the climate warms, they got nowhere to go. But I think before climate wipes them out, I think demography will. They're the smallest ethnic minority in Mongolia. Nobody aspires to be a reindeer herder. Everybody in the taiga is related to each other at the first cousin level, so marriage within the group is not possible. So to attract a marriage partner, you have to marry somebody from the other ethnic group in the area, the Darhat. And the Darhat generally don't aspire to be Dukha. So they have trouble attracting marriage partners, and I think that's the biggest problem they're facing right now. There are economic pressures too. A lot of the young people want to move to the city. They want to make money. They want to have cars. They want to have motorcycles. We'll see. I'm happy that I have this opportunity to study this while it's still happening, because I don't know if that's going to be true in 20 years. Yes, sir.
Is there a prevailing
There is a prevailing wind direction, and I have those data, and the wind is primarily out of the north, and the doors face south, and I don't know if those things are related. I will say, you know, I come from a very windy place in Wyoming. We're the kings of wind, and everybody says Mongolia looks just like Wyoming, and it does, but one major difference is it's not terribly windy in Wyoming, so I don't think wind has had a huge plays a big part. I will say that the south-facing doorways in Mongolia is not unique to the Dukha. This is how Mongolians set up their yurts as well. And the reason for that is not entirely clear. There are lots of stories about it, but you don't know. You know, I don't expect to get a lot of data this winter. I would like to, but one thing that's been really interesting about working with living people is you can ask them things, and sometimes you get a straight answer, and sometimes you don't. Sometimes when you're misled, I'm not sure it's intentional. People think they're doing one thing, when in fact, if you measure it, they're not really doing it. So when they tell me what goes on in the winter, I believe them, but I just want to confirm it. You know, I want to see it for myself. I also want to see if these patterns that I identified in the fall get even more extreme in the winter. The problem with the winter, if it's true what they say, I'll be sitting up there with a 13-year-old boy, and it'll be a couple of us in a teepee, so it's not a very diverse group, and it's not a very diverse group of activities. But it will be nice to at least document these things. And I will say that most Arctic ethnography and subarctic ethnography, the winter season is not really documented. So I want to document it. Yeah. You know, I have all these wonderful patterns. I have nothing to compare them to except themselves. So if you hopped across the border to Russia, would people use space similarly, interior and exterior space? I don't know. And I certainly would expect to see very different patterns in the tropics. For example, John Yellen, who studied the Kung, or Bushmen, and the Zhuangzi You know, he talks about the importance of shade and governing where people do things. You guys are very well aware of that here in Tucson, how important shade is when it's hot. Nobody even pays attention to shade up here. They also say in the Kalahari that houses aren't really used except for sleeping. So those two things alone, and you have exterior hearth features, would suggest to me that you have very, very different use of space in that environment than what I'm observing. And I would expect down here in the Sonoran Desert in prehistory, very, very different use of space as well. And I would really love to understand how these things play out in different environments. So I could see more work done in similar environments and more work done in very, very different environments. Hot and dry environments, hot and wet environments. So these people are shamanists, which is the, and this is kind of the homeland of shamanism. Dukha Mongols are famous for shamans, and so are the Tuvans. There's one shaman in the right or west taiga. I have not met her. And I have seen very little in the way of shamanism. I've seen a few little small family rituals that have been done. It's my impression that people are religious when they need to be, rather than practicing regular ceremonies or things. But I have to say, it's not the focus of my research. In terms of a location, throughout the taiga, when we're riding through the taiga, we will pass trees where people have tied ribbons, blue ribbons around them. They tell me these are sacred places. I don't know why. I haven't explored it in great depth. It hasn't been a focus of my work. But the wedding happened. They built a house right next to his parents' house. When he was out of town, he came back with his bride, and the wedding happened in that house. And I was invited. And I can tell you about the wedding if you're interested. But there wasn't a lot of religion obvious religion associated with it. There were a few small ritual things that were done.